So good morning, good afternoon, everyone. So welcome to session 11C, Flood Management. My name is Hui Li Chen, and I'm a senior lecturer in water engineering at Laboral University. Today, I will be chairing this session, and our reporter today is Xiu Chun Liang, a PhD student in Laboral University. In this session, we'll explore some new approach to flood management from different parts of the world. Today we have three speakers presenting on different topics ranging from GIS-based flood control to flash flood early warning system and drainage system improvement and so on. Please note for each presentation, so there will be a 10-minute video followed by a 10-minute for Q&A. Before we start, so a quick note is that if you have any questions during this session, please feel free to raise your virtual hand. We will enable your video or audio, or you can type your question in the chat box. Okay. For our first presentation, our first speaker will be Alpha from Nigeria. So the title will be Evaluation of Efficiency of GIS-based River Training for Flood Control. So we can start the first presentation now.
Hello, everyone. My name is Meshack Ilamafa. I'm making a presentation on the evaluation of efficiency of GIS-based river training for flood control, a case study of River Sumunaga in Nigeria. There are various definitions for flood by different authors, which are based on a number of factors. But generally, flood will refer to the inundation of an area which is normally dry. And this can be caused by a number of factors, which may include the inability of a river channel to carry the amount of runoff generated from its catchment area. And one of the factors that will probably lead to this inability of the river is when we have excessive meandering sections in the river, which may make it difficult for the river to contain the flow that comes from it. And this is the case of River Sumunaga in the eastern part of Nigeria. Now, Sumunaga is a historical area where the Oburu Salt Lake, which is one of the major places for salt production in Nigeria, is located. And because of this, there's some study significant so that we can protect most of the assets that are affected by this perennial flood in those places. So this is the map of the study area. Map of Africa showing Nigeria, Nigeria showing Ebonyi State, and within Ebonyi State, Ohazara local government, where Sumunaga is located. River Sumunaga is an engaged river, so there are no flow data that we can use for this study. So the study had to rely on rainfall runoff modeling technique for engaged catchment, and we used the SCS Cognova method for the study. The rainfall data were obtained from NIMET, that's Nigeria Metropolitan Agency, for six surrounding stations, which we used to interpolate for Sumunaga using the inverse distance weighted method, and the Gombele extreme value, which is the best distribution based on the goodness of fit test, was used to estimate the daily maximum of rainfall for 2 to 200 years return period. And the watershed delineation was carried out using Archhydro and Head GeoHMS tools in ArcGIS environment, using SRT and DEM and the drainage network of the area, which we extracted using advanced survey method, and the DEM were also collected using the ground control points that were obtained from the field. So this is the layout of Sumunaga River, and we can see that the Ure stream, which is a tributary of the Sumunaga River, flows over the salt lake that is of commercial significance. So as stated, previously. The SRTM dam that had been vertically corrected was used for the delineation, and that delineation was done at 3 points, 1 point just before the inflow from the salt lake, and then the other point at the outlet downstream, and then the third was the Urey stream, which flows from the salt lake. So having estimated the peak discharge, flood modeling was done in HECRAS 5.0.3, and it was done for the four scenarios, including the do nothing and the various level of training of the river sections. The efficiency was assessed using the flood depth and flood velocity. In as much as we desire decrease in flood depth, the excessive increase in flood velocity can also lead to scouring, because when you do shortcutting, there's an increase in velocity which can lead to scouring. So these factors were combined to see what is the most efficient river training section that can be done to curb the flood in the area. So this is the delineated watershed of the Asunava River system. So these are the estimated watershed characteristics for the Asunava River network. Okay, these are the discharge values that were estimated for 50 years, 100 years, and 200 years return period. So after carrying out the flood inundation mapping, these are the inundation extents overlaid on various elements, the built area, the Ekaja market, Uburu rice farm, Uburu salt lake, and the likes for 100 years return period based on various interventions. The body of note that the flood inundation mapping was done extensively on the 100 years return period flood. So these are the depths of inundation for various interventions. That's for the 100 years return period. We can see that the depths were reducing with the increase in the number of shortcutting. Of course, as expected, the velocity of inundation was increasing with the decrease in number of shortcutting, because as the shortcuttings were being done, the river flows faster. Now this table shows the element of risk at risk of both do nothing and intervention scenario and efficiency of the method. Now you will see that the various level of shortcutting achieve various level of efficiency. You can see the land area was reducing. The built areas that were at risk were no longer at risk for all the levels. The expressways that were at risk were reducing to a maximum of 48% efficiency, major roads and the likes. But the rice farm, you will see that there is an increase in the area. Why? Because of the change in the channel course, it was now entering into where they were farming before, which is not supposed to be a disadvantage anyway. So in order to come up with the best intervention option, we had to rank based on the flood depth, flood velocity, element or risk. And then we came up with a score, and the lowest score, 2.3, was obtained for the intervention 3, which involves shortcutting 3 out of the 4 boxbowl lakes. So here's a summary of what was presented, and I presented the details earlier. And we can see that there is a level of efficiency that has been obtained at various levels, and the best was obtained for intervention 3, which involves the straightening of the second, third, and fourth meanders to curb the flow. So, based on the findings of the study, a few recommendations were made, about 6 of them, that the second, third, and fourth critical meandering sections of the Asunnaga River between the two bridges should be straightened, and the excavated materials can be used to improve. improve the existing ridge that protects the salt lake from flooding by the river Sumnaga, and borrow materials can be used to fill Oxbow area in order to allow the water to pass through the new channel. Flood shoreline can be provided, should be provided and indicated by beacons at designated points. And we estimated a total of 23 beacons spaced at 15 meters apart to be provided to demarcate the flood shoreline, and no development should be allowed beyond the shoreline. Grassing of the river bank up to the flood shoreline, especially where there are no rice farms, should be carried out to minimize scouring the river bank erosion. So this study has shown that straightening of meandering sections of river can reduce the risk of flood, but care has to be taken to ensure that there is no excessive strengthening so that there will not be risk of scouring. Thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you, the speaker. Thank you, Alpha. I'm not sure Alpha is here or not. And if you, for audience, if you have any question, could you please type it in the chat box? So maybe later on, if Alpha can join us, we can ask him to pick up the question from the chat box. Okay, in this case, let's move to the second presentation. For the second presentation, we will have Qayyam from Pakistan, who will be presenting risk communication assessment of the flash flood early warning system in the Lai Basin of Pakistan. So now we will play his video.
Hello and welcome everybody to the current session of 43rd International Conference on Water and Climate Resilience, where we are going to discuss risk communication assessment of flash flood early warning system in Lai Basin of Pakistan under the theme of flood management. Let me introduce our team first. My name is Atif Qayyum and I have been research student in City and Regional Planning Department in University of Engineering and Technology, Lahore. Along with me is my research supervisor and the co-supervisors, Dr. Atif Bilal Aslam and Dr. Asim from the same institute of the UET Lahore, and Dr. Salman Asghar from Product and Industrial Design Department, University of Engineering and Technology, Lahore, the same university. Starting from the problem statement, we all know Pakistan is among the top exposed country toward increased risks of climate change. And we are witnessing it, we study about it, and we have research studies in this regard that place Pakistan among the top countries which are highly exposed to climate related disasters, especially when it comes to flood. Secondly, Pakistan's commitment to achieve SDGs, specifically those related to climate resilience and climate action, requires the research and exploration of the area of risk communication and early warning system so that the community's resilience can be enhanced. Additionally, we have limited research in the area of risk communication and early warning system functioning. So this created the need of a research study which we conducted. So we conducted the study with the following objectives: to understand the operation of early warning system and its efficiency, the community perception and risk communication level of exposed community, the relationship between demography and risk communication level, and effect of early warning system on risk communication. These were the key objectives which we were focusing during. So first of all, how important is an early warning system? Early warning system saves life, prevent damages, and enhance resilience. It has saved 200 lives per year with estimated financial benefits of 470 million to 2.8 billion euros in Europe, and it has potential to offer similar benefit. Like when we talk about low income countries, it has ability to offer a financial benefit of 103 million euros. To lower middle income countries, it has to offer 1,075 million euros in terms of financial benefits. And the potential which it can offer in terms of financial benefit for upper middle income countries is 3,825. So to achieve this benefit, what it is required to be to have an efficient early warning system? World Meteorological Organization, they have set some standards. UNISDR have some requirement, and Japan International Cooperation Agency, who is a designer and financer of LEI flash flood early warning system, they have set some standards. So let's summarize this. In time early warning issuance, clearly defined roles and responsibilities, participation of vulnerable communities, sufficient and dedicated staff, and financial resources for operation and maintenance, and continuous development, periodic training and professional development. These are the key requirements of an efficient early warning system. So moving toward LEI early warning system, let's have a look on study area profile. The study area is capital city Islamabad and its twin Rawalpindi. Both lie in Pothohar Plateau in northern region of province Punjab, and the area is currently rapidly urbanizing due to increased population, improved public service delivery, IDPs and refugees movement. And the LEI stream run across these two cities from Bargala Hills in Islamabad to Sohan River in Rawalpindi. LEI stream, locally known as Nalai LEI, is 30 km long with the catchment area of 235 km², and it often faces flood situation. There have been 19 significant flood events from 1959 to 2002. And one of the most devastating was that happened in 2001 as a result of cloudburst, which caused the loss of 74 human lives, 4 lakh people affected, 1,087 houses completely destroyed, and $0.25 billion lost in terms of property and infrastructure damage. After this flood, a comprehensive study was conducted, which led to establishment of LEI Flash Flood Task Force and establishment of LEI flash flood early warning system in the study area. This map here, it shows all the detail and components of flash flood early warning system. It has 6 rain gauges, 10 warning posts and 2 water level gauges, 3 master control station, one at Pakistan Meteorological Department, one at Federal Flood Commission, and one warning control station at Town Municipal Administration Rawalpindi, which is currently owned by Provincial Disaster Management Agency. So in order to meet the study objectives, we followed the methodology which is simplified and stated in this table. Convenient and quota sampling was carried out for interview of expert official in order to assess the operational aspect and efficiency of early warning system, and deductive thematic analysis was performed on this data. And in order to explore the community perspective, a community survey was carried out through simple random sampling with the sample size 384, and chi-square test was performed for analysis. The important aspect of this study is to convert the question related to community risk perception or risk communication into a risk communication index. All 3 questions were combined and they were awarded average weightage, weighted average, in order to convert into a risk communication index. And then the respondent were rated on this index, and the attained value was used for further analysis. This is the slide which shows that how the indicators were converted and how they were awarded weightage. The key finding from the interview data reflect that early warning system issues warning on time, and it has clearly defined roles and responsibilities. The staff training mode is non-periodic and occasional. Resources are there, but they are generic. Data processing, validation, and publication is not centralized, and community participation is passive. On the side of community perspective, 98% of respondents scored high on risk communication index, which shows community have good risk communication level. Communication of risk perception and flood warning system are independent of gender and education level. Age and flood experience relate significantly with flood risk communication and early warning system knowledge. And communities are aware that they are at risk, and warning issued is to make them alert, but they are not trained to make response. This is the graphical representation. This table simplifies the entire correlation between action variable and response variable. Gender not related, age related with risk communication, education has no impact on response variable, flood experience is closely related with risk communication and warning system. So the summary of these findings: live flash flood early warning system can be stated as efficient since it contributes positively to risk communication, and community flood risk communication and warning system knowledge is independent of demographic factor, and risk communication and warning system awareness are function of flood exposure and experience, and community participation is passive. The way forward is to conduct more studies around demography and community response. The localized climate model should be incorporated. A comprehensive study about economic, electrical, and hydrographic and hydrological aspect of future application, and testing it with local equipment so that its operation and maintenance could be made easy, and improve solid waste management. Some key references and question.
Thank you for the presenter, Kuayang. Yes, so any question for him? Yeah, I can see the presenter is online now. So maybe can we ask you to open your video or audio to see if there's any questions from the audience? So any question, Xiuchun?
Hello. So far there is no question in the chat box. So any question? Hello, Atif.
Hello, Atif. Can I ask one question? Yeah, I just wondering, so for the flood early warning system, so what warning it will be issued? So it's about what level is about where floods will occur, or maybe what risk where the risk will be. So what types of message the flood early warning system will be issued?
So there are sirens.
Sorry? It seems we lost the connection with Atif.
Okay.
Hello, Atif.
Yeah.
There are actually flood warning sirens, which are actually circulated for the whole community, and by giving some notice that they should be actually vacating the bridges and the nearby areas from the Lai area. Mm-hmm. And because sometimes it happens that when it becomes the sirening of the health hazard, or sometimes people actually come to the bridges to see the water level, which actually to invite actually more risk for their lives. So there are actually precautionary measures which are actually communicated to them. And then there are certain levels when they actually approached with respect to the water level, the siren actually turned on.
Okay. So how did the public get the message by phone message or by TV or any way for them to receive this message?
From the authority, it is actually for there are the sirens. Otherwise, they are actually getting the information continuously from the news channels. If there are some kind of risks about the excessive rainfalls, because most of the people, they do have TVs inside their houses, and there are continuous broadcasting of news channels who are actually also reporting some issues with respect to health risks. So people are get some kind of, and whenever there is a kind of cloud burst type rainfall, the people do have some understanding that it might pose some risks of urban flooding. So they actually become some kind of already sensitized about these risks, especially the people who are living quite close to these streams.
Okay, great. Yeah, thank you very much for providing such detailed answer. Yeah, really appreciate it. So let's see whether there's any questions from the audience. If no more questions for the second presentation, so we will move to our third presentation. Our third presentation will be from Shapen from Bangladesh. He will be discussing increasing drainage system performance through Nova Plastic with the management. Okay, now we'll play his video.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. It is my pleasure to be presenting this paper on behalf of Fariduzman Shapon. My name is Michael Pausty, and I work for Practical Action in Bangladesh as a research analyst supporting their broad portfolio of innovative urban projects. At Practical Action, we believe that big change starts small, and therefore we are committed to innovating both the types of solutions that we are working with and the modalities through which they are implemented. We want to find solutions that really work. In this presentation, I'll be sharing about a novel approach to plastic waste management that we believe can increase the drainage system performance in Faridpur, a secondary town in Bangladesh. Over the past 10 years, the World Bank, the Asian Development Bank, and other actors in the sector have been proactive in investing in the design and construction of concrete urban drainage systems. However, infrastructure solutions alone, which do not adequately integrate with broader waste management needs or consider social norms and behaviours, infrastructural solutions alone are ineffective at sustainably solving the drainage and waste challenges. The current practices of household, industrial, and building site waste being dumped on the side of the road, in drains, on riverbeds, and in ponds throughout the cities needs to change. This requires adequate attention to behaviour change psychology and incentivising new behaviours. This also has economic costs for the municipality, who have to, in the lead up to the wet season, clean out all of the drains in town. But even then, within days, the drainage channels begin to again accumulate plastic, dirt, sand, or paper. Now, the plastics which are found in the drainage system are those which don't have any monetary value. In Bangladesh and in Faridpur, PET bottles and other hard plastics hardly ever end up in the drainage system, as they are collected and sold to plastic recyclers prior to reaching the drainage system. Informal workers and even shop owners have an incentive, a financial incentive, to keep them out of the drains. However, soft plastics, like plastic bags, food packaging, currently have no market value, and therefore there is no incentive to collect and manage these plastics well. So practical action recognizes that the ultimate responsibility of waste management continues and needs to sit within the municipality. They are mandated for secondary town waste management. However, it needs to be an integrated solution, implementing NGO partnerships with private sector actors, the informal waste management sector, communities, and municipalities. And it also needs to adequately integrate both drainage system infrastructure, waste management, and poverty reduction. So practical action in partnership with private sector, municipality, communities, and the informal sector have been working on developing a proposal, a practical project which is able to address the problem of single-use plastic entering Forirpo's drainage systems and the environment. As I said before, PET bottles and other plastics have a market value. Therefore, if single-use plastics can have a market value attached to them, there is an incentive to keep them out of the drainage and waste streams. Now, in Forirpo, more than 600 waste workers are now actively engaging in the collection and transport of single-use soft plastics. A price point has been set so that each kilogram of soft plastics now has a value of about 25 taka per kilogram, and this has been based on extensive business modelling. Now the solution to this, the end goal, well not the end goal in the long term sense, but of this activity, is the use of a pyrolysis machine. Now, as I said, pyrolysis is not the ultimate end goal. The ultimate end goal continues to be the reduction of plastic waste generation. But in the interim, Practical Action has introduced a pyrolysis unit which is able to convert waste, soft plastic, and turn it into a fuel substitute which is suitable for diesel manufacturing equipment, diesel construction machinery, and local ships or boat use. Now, this is a vast improvement from the current plastic status quo, where plastics end up in the rivers and end up as ocean plastic, on land, contaminating soil and decreasing the productivity of agricultural land, or being burnt in the open. The particular unit that has been introduced is a much more advanced and environmentally a cleaner solution than the older pyrolysis units which can be found throughout Bangladesh already. So this is a much more advanced and sustainable model for an interim period as we advocate for Bangladesh to continue to decrease plastic waste generation. So what has been the progress to date? Well, the pyrolysis plant can convert single-use plastics into a saleable fossil fuel substitute. Additionally, the other product, black carbon, already has a pre-established market in Forirpo in the printing sector. So with both direct and indirect benefits expected from this model, modelling and costs and the performance of the plant to date demonstrates that the pyrolysis unit will run as a profitable business model with monthly profits of between $800 and $1,500 per month. The environmental performance continues to be such that on average we are seeing between 350 and 400 kilograms of plastic waste being collected and taken to the pyrolysis plant each day. So the fact that the plant's current performance is able to reduce 300 to 400 kilograms of plastic single-use plastics entering the environment is a huge achievement. This continues to be a small percentage of the total plastic waste, but it is a very much a step in the right direction. Unfortunately, this year's wet season has come late, and therefore we have not been able to collect the actual stormwater drainage system performance data that we would like to have been able to present to you today. However, that said, we are confident that this project will be having the roll-on impact of decreasing plastic into the drainage system, resulting in less drainage clogging and increased stormwater system performance. But we propose to share this data with you more broadly once this data is available. And as we started with, ultimately, the effectiveness and efficiency of this project will continue to be dependent on changing behaviours at home and establishing new waste disposal norms. This project has begun to really advocate for and implement at-home source segregation behaviour change, the ultimate aim being to change the way that plastic waste is managed in households and in community, leading to decreased waste disposal into the environment. So the implications for practice in Fouriedbourg is that both waste management and drainage management need to be integrated and not siloed, as is the current state. A market-driven solution can be developed that monetizes and provides an economic value to single-use plastic, but that social behavior change is desperately required. Thank you for your time. I look forward to answering any questions.
Thanks, Sharper, for such interesting research. Yeah, it seems Sharper is not here. And I can see there is one question from the chat box. How is the collection of the waste organized to ensure continued supply of waste materials to the system, and how are the households rewarded so that they continue collecting the waste? That's a great question, but unfortunately, the presenter is not here, so we may connect you with him through email. If that's fine, Violet. Okay, children, we may share the presenter's email. Through Violet to Violet. Okay, thank you. It seems Lucy can provide some more response. Children, can you make Lucy as a presenter? So that he can open the video.
Hello, Lucy. Can you accept the audio? Hello.
Yes, hi. I'm just clicking on the right button. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. So, hi. Yeah, this is Lucy. Lucy Stevens-Lantz, Threat Collection. And so how we are organizing, I work in the UK office, the head of the cities program. We have quite a bit of engagement with this project, but not necessarily all of the details. But how we are arranging the collection is that we have been working with existing waste collectors and have organized them in our approach is to organize people into cooperatives. Through the cooperatives, they are providing a house-to-house collection service. Households have to pay for a small amount for the collection service. They then provide their waste in like separated into recyclables and then also into wet waste, so that the recyclables come through. So that it's not necessarily like an incentive, but the incentive is that people have a reliable collection service. Then also we are also then for continuing to get a reliable supply, we are looking at two things. One is to connect more with some of the markets for fruit and vegetable and other type of markets. And we have also experimented a bit with river kind of barrages that float in the river to collect plastics from the rivers, because our partner River Recycle is able to claim some plastic credits, river plastic credits, for if plastics is collected out of the river or near the bank. So that is also something that the cooperatives are doing. So it comes from those different sources, basically.
Okay, thank you very much, Lucy. So you are working with Shapen?
Yes.
Oh, okay, great. Yeah, I think following this question, I got a question relevant with the presentation. So I'm thinking, yeah, it would be very interesting to see how the waste collection, the plastic collection from the river will impact the flood risk. Because I can imagine if lots of waste accumulate in the river, so that will impact the flood risk and the flooding pass. So have you think about this? Yeah, maybe quantify the risk change. Oh, okay, yeah.
In terms of the flooding that people experience in Faridpur, it's not usually the problem that the river overflows its banks. It's also that the kind of drainage within the town can't cope, and you get areas of waterlogging within the town, not so much that the river itself overflows its banks. So one of the key things is to ensure that the drainage system and the canals within the town itself are not blocked, more so than whether the river itself is blocked. But the collection points within the river are designed in a way that they shouldn't cause a blockage and cause a problem during flooding. The water flows can still flow very, very well. But of course, we'll continue to monitor the situation, because it would be very bad if that did cause that problem.
Yes, thank you very much. Because, yeah, for me, our group's research is focused on modeling flood risk, because I'm thinking this will be a very great case study for us. Yeah, use our model to see how the waste collection will impact the flood risk. Yeah, the difference between loss of waste and without loss of waste. We may follow up with a further chart about this. Yeah,
absolutely. We'd really welcome that. And obviously, it's it requires a partnership with academic researchers to really fully understand like where flood risks are coming from in any given location. So you'd be welcome to follow up. That would be great. Thanks.
Yeah. Okay, great. Thank you, Lucy. Yeah, so any question for Lucy?
Oh, there is one more question in the chat box. So what will happen to the plastic waste when they cannot be recycled? Lucy?
Yes. So there are, we're hoping that, so generally there's different types, obviously there are different types of plastic waste, right? So you've got sort of hard plastic, like the type you get in plastic bottles and those harder plastics. Those are, there's already a system for those that they're collected, and there's a good market for those. We were in this project trying to find or establish like an off-taking system and a market and creating a value for the types of waste that previously would have gone directly to the landfills, or if not the landfill, then they would have just been left in the open environment to drain into the rivers and pollute the land. So there should be only, that there shouldn't be other types of plastic which are kind of discarded. And if there are, they're probably going to be quite a small percentage. What happens with the collection system in general is that whatever type of waste that is collected that is not possible to be, that doesn't have any value or any off-taker, that gets taken to the, it gets taken to the landfill site. But the purpose of the project is to try to reduce a lot the plastics that have to go to, that don't have any value and just have to be discarded.
So any question, Xiuquan?
Well, the nightingale, there is a second question, but I think Lucy have partially answered this question, right? Is there any other for plastic waste than recycling? In the chat box.
In my chat box, it's really small. That I've made it a bit bigger. Is there any other use for plastic waste other than recycling?
Yeah, this is.
I'm wondering whether they mean like, can it be made into anything else? Like sometimes people make products directly out of plastic waste rather than recycling it, as a use for it. And I am not aware of any of that happening in Faridpool. So the plastic wastes of different types that are collected generally go for recycling. Can it be made into something else? Some people use it for building. Okay, so the process that we are using here is to produce, as we've explained, to use the pyrolysis process and produce an oil, a fuel oil and black carbon, but our partner, River Recycle, is also looking at production of a high quality building material board that they would produce, that could be used for construction purposes. And we've also experimented with making some kinds of pressed plastic products from the machinery as well. So the ones that River Recycle are thinking about would have a very high safety standard. Like if they're going to be used in construction, you have to make sure that they're not combustible. So they go through quite a high quality process to make sure that they can be used for that. So that is one option that we're also that our partner is also exploring as another potential avenue for this type of thin film plastic, so that they're looking at whether the business model for that would also make sense.
Okay, thank you, Lucy. Yeah, thank you, everyone. Xiuquan, no. Okay.
Currently no more question, I think. Yeah.
Okay, great. It seems our first presenter still not appeared. So we may end here for our three presentations. So thank you for all our three speakers. speakers for their excellent contributions and also to our audience for your thoughtful questions. So at end of the session, so please check the four timetable to find out what the next session starts. And in the meantime, you may want to take a tour of the poster gallery and also other different things, and also take a look at the download session and to see what is there. So this is some guidance. Come up at 11:30. So there will be same presentations start from 11:30. And the theme will include water security, complex area, water financing and the payment system, and water service delivery models. So we hope we can see you there soon. So for this session, we'll close here. Thank you, everyone.